Yes, indeed. I want to extend a bit about the things that I also discussed in the earlier morning. And in this case, I will address more the social network application area. So remember that the networks are described by three different types of characteristics: the omegas for the connections weights, the aggregation, we have the functions, the combination functions, and the speed factors. And we have a number of functions in the library, which can easily also be extended and can also be composed so that you can make infinite number of them. So the perspective is from a network-oriented modeling side, where you have role matrices, and you have hidden equations like this, where the axis influences the Y in the standard causal network sense. And then also the characteristics have their influences from their own specific roles. So that's the whole idea that I just in a very short time recalling now. And but I want to, this time I want to have some more attention to the social network application area. So remember the self-modeling network ID. We, for a number of characteristics, for example, this one, we create extra nodes in the network. So you specify the nodes and then you have an extended network, and that's the self-modeling network. So the real world context defines usually causal pathways. And the network structure is actually what they what is modeling that. So there is a kind of configuration of the world. That's what I call the context here. And they are contextual causal factors as well. And for example, if you have a car driving, you press the accelerator and it drives just passing the whole way, and that's just like you would expect from physical laws. But if the configuration of the world is different, then you get this crash. So that's a completely different outcome. Therefore, this configuration of the world also has its impact on what really happens, what actually happens. So that's the idea of this contextual influences on your processes. So now we have this self-modeling networks, then you can have you can model adaptive networks in a uniform, declarative, and also network-oriented manner by network concepts. And you can iterate it easily to higher levels, higher order adaptive networks. In the main talk in the earlier morning, I took the examples for the applications from the neuroscience area. And now I will do it for the social science area. So this is one, you remember that I already gave more than a handful of examples of adaptation principles. So one of my, the things that I do for my living is to collect such adaptation principles from the literature. And I've collected already around 15 or 20 of them from literature. They are, say, nature-based or nature-inspired types of adaptation. If you would consider this from the machine learning perspective, they would just be types of learning methods, but they're not artificial ones, but just natural ones, just developed by nature. So now I will show some of them that are more for the social science side. This is one, bonding by homophily. That's sometimes stated like birds of a feather flock together. That means if you are a bit the same, you're a bit similar, then you are attracted to have some more stronger connections. And this is another one, the more becomes more adaptation principle. Sometimes this is also called the Matthew effect or preferential attachment. Persons with more connections attract more connections. So if you want to follow other people on social media, when some other people are very popular, probably you are more tending to connect to that person too. This is another one, interaction connects adaptation principle. If you work together or you sing together or you dance together with some person, then there's a good chance that the connection will become stronger over time. So I will focus now on the bonding by homophily adaptation principle. Then we have a self-model state for the connection. And you may recall the picture for the habit learning, and this is exactly the same picture. Because on the level of the connections, this adaptation principle has the same structure as habit learning. You just need information from the two properties of the two persons to be able to see whether or not they are similar. And then you can have the effect of the connection for them, this connection. So that's the same, but the difference is in the aggregation, because this is a different form of aggregation that's needed for this principle. So this is the flocking together, and this is the birth of a feather side. So that's the self model for this. So then the connectivity. We need incoming connections. Yeah, that's what we already saw. We need the outgoing connection. That's the pink downward arrow. But we also need aggregation. That was not specified in the picture. Those pictures only specify part of your network structure. Remember that you need a connectivity, aggregation, and timing. And this is the picture is only connectivity, and even not the labels of the connections, only the occurrence of the label of the connections. So this is the function that is used, it's also in the library, is used for the bonding by homophily adaptation principle. There are many of them in the library, and at least more than a handful. And I also have in the 2020 book a chapter with an overview of many of them and some mathematics of their properties. So this is I will explain it now. So this is the formula. Again, just a declarative mathematical relation. No learning method described by program code or at least an algorithm description, as you often see, just a declarative description. So the birds of a feather, that means that there is a high extent of similarity. And that's expressed by that the difference between the two activation levels of the two states that are connected is smaller than certain threshold or tipping point tau. So that means that like the tipping point may be 0.15 and on a scale of 0 to 1, then if this difference is smaller than 0.15, then you consider that there is a high extent of similarity. Well, you can, of course, rewrite this easily into this form. And now it happens that in the formula, this form is just there. That part is just that part of the formula. And now we also have the flock together part. And that means that the connection becomes stronger if this high extent of similarity is there. Then the connection weight should increase. Now you see that this criterion of high extent of similarity, it means that then this part is positive, and this is also positive. So that means you add to the current connection weight. Therefore, it becomes stronger. So this is how this formula works. And these factors here are just for normalization within the 0-1 interval, that it stays in that interval. So that's the explanation of this function. There are a number of other functions, like you can also have quadratic forms here or other types of functions. And that's in the book in one of the chapters more extensively described. So we consider this. You can also do mathematical analysis of this. Remember that we have this equilibrium equation. That means that the combination function value is equal to the current value of your connection in this case. So then you have this equation, and we know that this is the formula. So therefore you get this equation. Well, this becomes very simple. These W's can be taken out. Then we have only a product of three factors, and that's easy. We have solutions W is 0 or W is 1, or the difference between the two is exactly the tipping point. that's a kind of unstable, usually unstable equilibrium, because it's very delicate to have these values exactly at that point. But in many cases in practice, you see that these types of equilibrium values are the ones that occur. And that can be used in many cases to explain how in society or within populations or groups, segregation takes place, or clustering of equally minded persons, or community formation. So there's a lot of literature that describes those processes, and this model for bonding by homophily can just describe it, because this W is zero. These are the cases of two persons in different clusters, different communities, and these are for the persons within one community, within one cluster. So that's how it often happens. If you do simulations, usually that's just the outcome, that you see some automatic clustering taking place. From a machine learning perspective, you would call it non-supervised, I think, in this case, because there is no, it's just an emerging process. So this is in chapter 13 of that book. You can find more of such analysis also for different types of functions. So the multi-level self-model is used to have also higher orders of adaptation. And that's indeed that we also can address for the social side, social science examples. For the mental networks, we had this already in the talk in the earlier morning. But now I will show you how you can apply similar ideas for the social area. So this is an example of faking homophily. So you may be aware that sometimes people just fake that they are similar to somebody else. Suppose you meet somebody and you feel a bit attracted to that person, and you know that that person likes a specific type of music, but you actually don't like that type of music. Would you say that? Probably not. Most people will not say that. And maybe instead they will suggest they also do like that type of music, even if they don't do that. So that's what I called bonding by faked homophily, because that mechanism can just work. If you are faking it, and you will also keep on faking it forever, of course, that you should also do that, then the bonding can actually take place. And this model describes how that works. So this is these states are representing whether or not the person likes a certain type of music. So this is for person A and this is for person B. But person B has also another state, namely
okay,
the fake.
You have 2 minutes.
Okay. He has also a fake state for it. That's this one. So this is the only state that person A can see. This is in a sense hidden. And the social contagion makes these types of connections. So, and that is then social contagion from faking B to A. So let's consider then the self model, the first order self model. There are representations of the connections. These are the representations of the connections. So you, it's the ID that you have of your connection to the other person. And then these are the representations of the state. This is the representation of, let me see. So this is the B, the real B. This is the own representation of B it himself about his own type of music, whether or not he likes this type of music. This is from A, from the other person. But these are the ones from each other. This is how A perceives B. And that's by the faked. So this is a kind of false representation, because it's not a representation of this one, but of the faked state for B. So that makes that the connection from A to B has input from a faked representation, and therefore it's a form of faking, a bonding by faked information, in fact. Information that has faking basis, at least. So these are the different representations that play a role. So note that in this case, we use bonding by homophily, not by the real homophily, but by the perceived homophily. What is exceptional in literature? In the literature, they usually model it in an objective way.
Sorry, your time is up.
Sorry?
You can maybe take about 3 minutes more. Yeah, go ahead, keep going. Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. So this is a different way of modeling that than you usually see in the literature, where they just let the bonding work on the objective states. But of course, what you think in your mind is even more important for your bonding. So therefore, I think this is a bit more realistic to use the representations of what you think about your states and each other states. And also in this case, false representation is possible. In the other case, it's not. So then we have this bonding here. And for the control of this whole process, we have a second adaptation level where you can control the different formation of the representations so that you can decide to look at somebody, for example, or decide to communicate so that you can get information from each other. So I will not go in too much detail about that. So this becomes then the total model. So this is the effectuation of the control. And so then we have in total a second order adaptive social network model for this connection between A and B, which has two sides, two directions. So it is again, like in the morning, we have this format for it, where we have these different adaptation parts in it. These are the adaptive ones. And then it describes the whole network model. Then we have, I want to continue to the graphs. So this is the graph of the sample. You have different states here. Let me see. That's the forming your own representation by A. And this is by B. And then this is forming the faked representation by B. And this is the fake state of B. And this is the control states for observation. There are two of them. They have actually the same curve because they got the same numbers in this example. And this is for the communication, control for the communication. So these are the other ones. Then we have here the forming each other state representations, of course, very important for the homophily principle, even the faked one. Then we have, this is actually the bonding by homophily. So then you see that indeed that mechanism works. Due to the faked representations, the connections become strong on both sides, not only one side. So therefore you can say it's a successful strategy. But of course you have to continue it forever. If you later on admit that it was fake, then it's not a good situation. Okay, so I think this can be the end of it. I have some last comments here. You can find also on my ResearchGate site these slides if you want to see them back. Okay, thank you.
Okay, thank you. Thank you very much. Right. Okay. So the presentation is open for questions, please.